Hello, Edwina. Murphy-Droomer is my name, and I want to warmly welcome you to this interview in the series that is all about unleashing the audacious woman within. Today, we have with us Abigail Rebecca. Abigail is a visibility coach and international speaker and the creator of Illuminated Leaders. Today, I'm going to dive into conversations with Abby around the law of attraction, one of my favorite subjects, but also her understanding of the age of Aquarius and how that ties into us needing more empowered, more fully expressed, more wealthy women in the world right now. Welcome, Abby, and thank you so much for being with us today.
Thanks, Edwina. It's such a pleasure to come on and be part of this beautiful project and this movement that you're creating. Thank you so much.
We were having a little giggle just before we pressed record because your nails are matching my top. We've got this fantastic coordination.
It's like we planned it.
Oh, yeah. Love it. Love it. So, Abby, for those in our audience that haven't had the pleasure of meeting you yet, could you take a minute to tell us, or longer, to tell us your story and how you came to be doing the work that you do?
Yeah, of course, I'd love to. I'll try and be as concise as possible. So I built, let me just start off with how I used to feel. I used to wake up every day, I used to feel really anxious, mm-hmm. like there was a million things to do, there was a million things on my mind. And all I wanted to do was wake up every day and be happy. That was my goal. And I built this very successful corporate career over 20 years span. I was operating at a very high level. I was a senior leader. I was managing big teams and big projects and big budgets, but I was desperately unhappy. I didn't feel like I really fit in. There was something inside of me that was calling me to do something different, but I thought that that was the only way that I could earn money. I had a good salary, so I was like, I'm just going to stay for the money.
Yeah.
And I just didn't think that it was possible to create a different life outside of corporate. And my body had different ideas. So as happens with a lot of women that I speak to who are doing something that they're not aligned to and they're not happy, it started to physically manifest in my body. I had a very, very bad heart condition. I ignored it and just carried on working. And it wasn't until the third time that it was really, really bad. I mean, it was like I was being rushed into hospital probably about 3-4 times a year, heartbeat 240. I mean, it should be around about 60, 70, so it's pretty high. And I just thought enough is enough, and I decided to leave. But at that time, during that really unhappy period, I'd also discovered the law of attraction. I'd actually met my partner, Kev, who I'm with now, and he had introduced me to the law of attraction. It was a beautiful gift that he'd given me when we first started dating. And I started to play around with it and have fun with it. And I was like, oh, what can I manifest? And I manifest redundancy. We say in the UK redundancy, like a payout, like a severance pay. So that enabled me to leave corporate, which was amazing. I built my business. It was, guess what? I built my business the same as I built corporate. So it was the only way that I knew how to build build a business. I was working, still working really hard, really stressed out. So then I was going and spending loads of money on like high level coaching programs, working with personal coaches. I was like back and forth from the UK to the States a lot. Throughout the years, and still nothing was really sticking with me. And I remember really, really clearly I'd flown over to San Francisco to do a VIP day with a client, and I'd met a couple of friends the day after, and they were really successful entrepreneurs who I'd met on a mastermind group. And I remember very clearly it's like I'm there now. I'm sat at the back of their car and they're at the front talking really excitedly about what restaurants they want to go to. And I'm like, I can't afford this. It's too expensive. And in that moment, I just thought I've got to be really vulnerable and I've got to share with them. And I was so used to trying to look good all the time. You know, I've got everything together, like I'm really successful. Like I was so obsessed with looking good. I didn't want to look bad. And I just sat there and I cried and said, I just can't afford it. And I really opened up to them about how I was struggling within my business. And they in turn opened up to me, and I just thought, oh my goodness, what is this? Like, when you stop being vulnerable and stop trying to look good, like you've got your shit together all the time, guess what happens? Other people open up to you. So that really started me off on another trajectory, and I started looking at really what stops women really speaking their truth, like being visible and standing up and being visible, but in a very authentic way. And that's when I really started my journey, you know, into discovering myself, loving myself, and in turn, really feeling this big need and almost like this obsession to help other female entrepreneurs do the same. So now what I do is I work with really purpose-driven entrepreneurs who are very visionary. And they want to create more success within their business, but they're hiding and they're not being vulnerable. So I connect them together and I help them overcome, you know, the beliefs, the patriarchal beliefs of, I can't be too beautiful, I can't be too clever, I can't be too rich, I can't be too, you know, I can't be too visible. So I help them overcome that and create these beautiful spaces where they can really stand up and have the confidence to be visible.
Yeah. There is a beautiful theme coming out of this series. And I'm always intrigued when I pull women together in a series like this. There's always a theme, a running thread. And it really is the bravery that comes with being authentic, that comes with actually owning who we are and showing up with confidence. It takes practice, but isn't it interesting that is, you know, we've built these societies where we just bury ourselves under all the shoulds, who we should be in the world, how we should look, how we should behave, what career we should have. That's a lot of shoulding on ourselves. And, you know, like the ability to start to let go of that and show up is the true act of bravery. Interesting. Yeah.
Yeah, it is. There's lots of shoulds. Yeah. I see it all the time. Yeah. So I love the fact that that's coming out now on your series.
So you talked about patriarchal beliefs, and I think this is something really interesting. There's a couple of things that I want to talk to you about within this, but let's dive in there, because what does that actually mean? How does that show up?
Well, if you think about, just to give a little bit of background and context, if you think about thousands and thousands of years ago, you know, we were revered as women. Women were goddesses, literally goddesses. The temples were built in women's images. You know, we were revered for our, I mean, women are freaking, we've got superpowers. We're creators, hello. Like I always say that our womb is our cauldron. Like we're so good at creating and manifesting and connecting and collaborating. We've got all these special powers. And then something happened along the way that I think, you know, there were men were intimidated by that power and then started to really sort of create this patriarchal world where women weren't revered anymore. Women became the weaker sex. Women became controlled. Women were victimized. I mean, if you think about the witch trials, thousands and thousands and thousands of women tortured and massacred, you know, turning mother against daughter and daughter against mother. We carry all the scars of that. We carry the scars of that through our feminine line. And I think now is such a really important time for us as women. It's a really important time for men as well, because actually what's happening is that there's this real movement and empowerment of women where women are rising, and we're actually starting to recognize this as women. You know, we're actually starting to support one another and collaborate, and the cattiness and the bitchiness is being looked upon as something that we don't really want to participate in anymore. And actually it's about sisterhood, but there is still this patriarchal huge I'm saying there's still this pain. We're still living in patriarchy, you know, it's still in its death throes. You know, I read this amazing quote the other day where somebody said they don't need to burn us anymore, they just give us the torch and we do it ourselves. You know, so if you think about the way that we think of ourselves as women, you know, we often think about ourselves as women, we can't be too, you know, or look at her over there showing off. Look at her, who does she think she is? You know, there's all these comments that we grew up with. I remember when I was little, you know, I wasn't like, you need to be quiet, do what you're told, sit down and be quiet. You know, my brothers weren't told that. My brothers were encouraged to be loud and bold and audacious and to climb trees and fall off. And I was like, you know, oh no, you can't do that. You know, you're a girl and you need to be a lady. You need to act ladylike. So there's all these constraints that society gives us, but also what we give ourselves. And I have this deep, deep desire, and this is what I do. I really work with women. You know, I see women and they've become very, very successful within their business, but they're completely burnt out. They think that they have to work really, really hard for money. Leadership is seen as, like, you look at the successful female leaders, like that really feminine energy. The New Zealand Prime Minister, she is incredible. I mean, breastfeeding, you know, while giving a speech in Parliament is incredible. So, you know, there's some real role models of women that are coming in, and I really teach how to bring the female and the male energy together. And then you've got a balance. But our gifts and our zone of genius is resting and being still and creating, and I see that as really, really powerful leadership energy.
Yeah. I did a leadership course in the US last year, and it was predominantly women. It's happening. It's happening. I feel like, you know, we talked a little bit before we hit record about this period of transition, or you said, you know, like you termed it as being in the birth canal. But I think we're in this really tumultuous period. I don't know how long it's going to last, but I... As agonizing as so much of it is, I feel like it's necessary. I feel like the world is just getting this great big shaker, and what's going to come out the other side is something that we really needed. So you actually, I was pulled off your website. You talk about the age of Aquarius. What's that?
So the age of Aquarius is so I believe, you know, there's a big belief system spread across the whole universe about this, is that we are now in the age of Aquarius. So patriarchy that I was talking about was the Piscean age that ended in 2012. So the Piscean age was very much about the control, like the world being run by white men. Okay, so the control, the male control, and the keeping information to themselves. So if you look at the leaders, the corporate leaders, the world leaders, you know, there was not a share of wealth, there was not a spread of wealth and knowledge. The rich were very rich, they kept their riches to themselves, they kept the knowledge and the power to themselves. And now guess what? We're in the age of technology. We're in the age of Aquarius, which is all about information sharing. So yes, I'm sure there's still so many secrets in this world that are going to be uncovered, but actually everything is so much more accessible. So this whole movement that we're going into now, we're really, really starting to go into the age of Aquarius, where, you know, there's an equality, there's information sharing, there's collaboration. And that's why as women, we are such incredible leaders in this new age, because that's our juiciness. That's our zone of genius. So as the goddesses are rising, when one woman rises, we all rise. And then the men are going to be there supporting us to rise so that we're equal. Nobody's going to be better than the women aren't rising to be better than the men. Yeah. You know, we're all going to be equal. And that's why I really, really love, you know, all of my work is underpinned by law of attraction. And that's why I love about law of attraction, because it's about knowledge sharing. You know, for centuries, all this knowledge was kept under wraps. It was secret. And now it's out there for anyone to experience. Yeah. It's possible for anyone.
The whole schooling system needs to change to support this. I'm, you know, like I'm seeing, and I guess because I'm so immersed in this world as are you, the way that we share knowledge now is through lived experience rather than just through textbook. You know, you and I have grown up in an era where knowledge came from textbooks and you go to university or TAFE or school, and that's the only form of knowledge that is valid. We let go of, you know, the wisdom of our elders and learning, you know, these knowledge passed down from generations. It's like mothers were the right to educate your children was taken away because you haven't been to university and learned how to be a teacher, so you can't teach your child. You know, this mentality, we get to start shifting it because now we have this access to incredible minds like yours that we just get to share with the world and keep passing this beautiful knowledge on. So let's dive into the law of attraction, because it's one of my favorite subjects. So can you maybe share some stories, or how do you utilize, first of all, what is it and how do you utilize it in your life?
Okay. So everything that I do and everything that I teach is underpinned by the law of attraction, and I use it every single day, and I share my clients to use it every single day. So the law of attraction is a universal law, the same as gravity. And you know, there's people out there that believe it, that use it very, very successfully. And there's people out there that don't believe it. And that's absolutely fine. You can believe what you believe. Whether you believe it or not, it still exists. It's just there. Yeah, so the way that I like to look at it is that we shape our current reality. My reality is very, very different to your reality, Edwina. Very different. We could go on vacation together and stay in exactly the same hotel, in the same room, eat the same food, swim in the same pool, go on the same excursions, and we will have a different experience. And the reason that we'll have a different experience is because I will relate to things differently to you because we've got different childhood experiences. So my view of the world is very different to yours, but also the way that we're thinking will shape what we see. So, you know, it's no coincidence that if I start to think about a yellow car, you know, I'm sat here in the countryside, but there's a little country lane outside my window. I'm sure there'll be a yellow car that will come along very, very soon because it's in my thoughts. So your thoughts become things. You can actually, our reality is completely made up and created by us. It doesn't exist. If you've ever watched the film, The Matrix is actually very true to our current reality. It's all made up. It doesn't exist. Time doesn't exist. You know, and there's a lot of yellow van's just gone by. Yellow van has just driven by the window. So there you go. That's law of attraction. Your thoughts become things. Now imagine if that yellow van was $1 million.
Yeah.
Even now, I'm like, oh my goodness, I've got like my crown chakras. So I can manifest a yellow van like that so easily. Why can't I manifest $1 million? Well, I can, but maybe I think it's easier to manifest a yellow van than it is to manifest $1 million. So what I do then with my work with my clients is I help them change their perspective on that. So it is just, you can manifest anything that you want. It's just our thoughts about how hard or how easy it is stop us from doing that. Yeah. And you know, we can and there's lots of techniques to bring it to life. Like you can start to visualize, you know, if I use an example of $1 million, you can start to visualize it for $1 million. You start to act like you've got $1 million. You know, like if you had a phone call from the bank today that said, hey, we're going to put $1 million in your bank account tomorrow, how would you act? How would you behave? You know, so you just act the same way. I don't mean to say to go out and spend it all, but you know, you'd start to think, oh, what am I going to spend it on? I know I'm going to go here on vacation and I'm going to buy that car and I'm going to treat my family to this. And, you know, so it's like acting like it's already coming in. It's such a beautiful gift to give to anyone, and anyone can do it, from children to, you know, to adults, from poor people to rich people. Anyone has got access to it. It's incredible.
Yeah, I was having a conversation this afternoon with my daughter about how we create our own reality. And I mean, you've done a beautiful job of describing it. What I said to her is, as trying to use examples that she could understand, was, you know, we find what we focus on. We find what we look evident. What we look for evidence of. So if I believe that eating animals is evil and wrong, and, you know, vegan diet is the only way to go, I can find a plethora of information to support that. If I believe that being paleo is the only way to support my health, I can find a plethora of examples and experts to support that belief. If I believe, you know, it doesn't, you can pick any belief. If I believe that, I'm just going to go blank, but even, you know, like in appearances, with our clothes, with anything, you know, if we believe that success only comes if you wear a pinstripe suit and you work in a corporate building, then we can find evidence of that. That's the reality that we can create. And I think at the moment, right now, the most, you know, the hottest topic is finding reasons to lose hope and to be very fearful, because there's plenty of evidence to support that in the world with COVID at the moment. But there's also lots of evidence to support that this is a time for hope and possibility and growth and vision. Anyway.
And just really quickly off the back end of that, because it's a really good point that you've raised. It's a really good way to position it. We are run by our ego mind,
yeah.
Right? So, you know, just in my story, I just wanted to look good all the time. We want to look good all the time. We want to be right all the time. So we are constantly looking for things to prove that we're right. I'm right and you're wrong. So if you believe, it's like you say, if you believe that I'm just going to live a life of struggle and life's going to be hard for me and it's going to be really difficult to make money, guess what? You're going to be creating a reality for yourself that goes, hey, guess what? Yeah, I'm right. Life is difficult. But actually, if you reposition that and say, you know what? Life is just in flow. Everything comes to me really easily. I can create wealth. I'm so successful. I've got many friends. I look at this beautiful house that I live in. Everything's really easy. I manifest things really easy. That you're going to be looking for things to prove yourself right. So just remember that. Decide what you want and then go for it, and it will become your reality, just like that yellow van became my reality in my world today.
So I'm curious how, you know, there seems to be so many different ways to do this. Do you write daily? Do you do a yearly vision board? Do you just set goals for yourself in certain periods of time, or how do you do it?
You know what, Edwina, I'd love to say that I sit and I journal every day and that's my daily practice, but I don't. I don't. And you know what? Every week I'm like, oh, I really need to start journaling. Yeah. And I just don't. I don't. You know what I love to do, and the process that I teach is, I love to draw. I love to release my inner child. I think when you release your inner child and you get the coloring pens out, what happens is, like, you kind of, like, a lot of your limiting beliefs disappear because you're in fun, you're in play. So if you obviously you've got a lot of mums in your audience, and I know that you've done series before around mums. But if you look at your child, you know, when they're in play, they're just so free and easy. If you ask a 6-7-year-old what they want to do, you know, if they say, I want to be an astronaut, they're like, oh, I'm going to be an astronaut. Like, there's no limiting beliefs or doubts that come up. They're going to go, oh, well, maybe I'm not clever to be an astronaut. Being an astronaut takes a lot of money. Maybe I can't afford it. They're not even thinking that. They're like, I'm going to be an astronaut. It's only as we get older that we start to put those restrictions on ourselves. It's self-imposed restrictions. So, you know, I've held retreats in beautiful, beautiful villas with like seven-figure women. And I've got them on the floor with big piece of paper and coloring crayons. And I'm like, right, color, what's your next steps? What's your dreams? So I like to create that. I love vision boards. I haven't got one on the go at the moment. Maybe I should do one soon. But I love to create it from my mind because I do feel that this whole creative process, you think of a thought in your head, it doesn't exist at the moment. It's just in your head. When you actually start to either write it, so you can journal it or draw it, it's a lot more fun to draw it, in my opinion, you're then bringing it into the reality. You're bringing it into this present reality. So there you go, you bring it into fruition. And then the way that you actually then create success from that idea is that you start to share it. You start to share it and you start to enroll other people in that idea. You can pick up the phone and you can call people, but if you want to be highly visible, you can start to be interviewed as an expert, go onto stages, like create your own events, do Facebook Lives, whatever it is. You're consistently, the way that I see visibility is that you're consistently showing up as an expert in the faces of other people in the area of whatever your zone of genius is, whatever you teach. So that whole enrollment, that whole conversation is so important. And the more people you can access, the more people the more people you will reach, the more successful you'll be. So I love that process and I visualize a lot. I love to visualize. I will literally we've got a beautiful big garden. We're surrounded by fields and sheep and cows. And I've got a hammock underneath a tree. And I've got wing chimes on this beautiful oak tree. And I just lie on the hammock and I visualize, you know, where are we going to go next? Who are the women that I'm going to work with? What events am I going to create? How much money am I going to be bringing in? Like just, and really get in that moment because the brain doesn't know any difference between reality and fantasy.
Yeah. So that's a very feminine energy, isn't it? That creative energy. And I would love for you to talk. It's something that I really love to drive home for women is an understanding of the difference between feminine and masculine energy. The fact that we have both, we need that, we need both. But if you can talk about that a bit, it's just a topic that I think is so important for people to understand.
Yeah, so we do have both and it's our natural state to have both for men and women. Yeah. You know, if you look at nature, there's masculine and feminine energy. And the best way that I like to describe it is, you know, feminine energy is the stillness, it's the creation, it's the creative stage. So if you think about the feminine energy like being in a valley, you're in a valley and you're held and you're secure and you are literally there planning, creating things, bringing things in. Like it's all about the stillness and the peacefulness. So that whole creation stage, you know, if I look at, like, if I'm going to launch a new product, if I'm going to do a new retreat, something like that, I'm starting it from scratch. I really, really love that creative process. I'm creating something really, really beautiful. So in that time, I'm like, ooh, doing a lot of meditation. I'm spending a lot of time in nature. We've got a beautiful, but very rusty 1973 VW camper van called Flossie. I'll drive Flossie somewhere and I'll put on some beautiful like meditation music and I'll create in Flossie. Yeah. So it's just that beautiful feminine stillness, that energy, that knowing, that, you know, abundance. And then the male energy, you need the male energy because otherwise you're just going to be creating all the time. You're not going to be getting anything done. Like you've got to then drive it forward. So the male energy is driving forward. So if you think about, like, it's very powerful. Like if you think about on a hill, we've got a place in the south of France. We go to the south of France a lot, just outside Cannes. We'll be driving through the valley. The biggest villas are built at the top of the hill. there's a reason the biggest villas are built at the top of the hill, because that's where the powerful people live. Yeah. And the people that have got that male energy, that not just like think things up, but they actually drive it through and create success. Right. So if you think of that energy, it's the doing, it's the action, it's the going out and going, come on, come with me. You know, it's doing what you're doing now. You know, it's bringing people together and saying, hey, I've got this great idea. I want to create a movement and I want to give it to the world. Like, are you on? Are you on board? And we're like, yay. Yeah. So that is the male and the female energy. And when the two come together, it's this beautiful alignment. And then guess what? You can create, all your ideas can come true. Like, you can bring everything into fruition. Yeah. But there's a real imbalance. You know, there's been a real imbalance with men for thousands of years. They've had the male energy. They haven't had the female energy. Mm. And there's a lot of grief that's coming from them. Mm. Like, and now they're kind of like, oh, okay, what's going on here? We need to reposition. Mm. And the women, you know, the only way that we've ever been successful is to have that male energy. You know, if I think about when I was in corporate, I was completely like complete male energy. I wouldn't even dare show any of my feminine vulnerability. They'd get rid of me. Like, why would I do that? But that's what really caused that heart, you know, literally my heart broke, because you can't operate just with one energy. You need the two.
Absolutely. You explained it beautifully. Thank you. So I imagine that there's going to be women in the audience listening that are intrigued how you moved from the corporate world into the entrepreneurial world. So yes, this is we're shifting gears altogether here, but I really want this to be a space where people have a clear picture or an understanding, and we can plant the seeds of possibility for women who perhaps have lost jobs and are looking at moving into the entrepreneurial space. There's lots of different ways to do it. But how did you do it?
Well, you know, as I said at the very beginning, I was feeling very unhappy in my corporate career anyway, but I just didn't see that there was another way to earn money. I was in a real, like, fear. Yeah. Trap. Actually, I felt trapped by my corporate job. I loved the money that was coming in because it afforded me a lovely lifestyle, and, you know, I could go on vacation and all of that. And I worked in the travel industry as well, so, you know, my job wasn't that bad. I used to get to travel quite a lot. And then obviously when I had my heart condition, that was really the wake up call. So I think, you know, if you look at any story, like any like Disney story, for example, there's always a journey that the hero follows. And there's always like an event that happens in their lives that really jolts them. And it might be something that they've created themselves, or it might be something that is completely out of their hands, but actually that's a clear sign. So if you think about what's happening in the world at the moment, you can either look at, oh my goodness, this is crazy, what on earth is going on, it's so scary, everybody's, you know, people are losing their jobs, people are being controlled, da, da, da. Or you could look at it, there is a complete paradigm shift here, and this is an incredible opportunity. And if you are in a position where actually what that's done is that's created a situation where you no longer have a job, I really want you to look at this as an opportunity. It really is an opportunity, because actually, what is it that you really want to do? So I think what happened with, you know, COVID creating a job loss maybe for you is what my heart did to me. So with my heart condition, I realized I had to leave, and I just thought, okay, what do I really want to do? It was a wake up call, and it was a chance for me to really reflect on what do I want to do? What brings me joy? Just forget about the money. Like, just forget about that at the moment, because that's obviously the thing that's keeping me trapped. Mm-hmm. Actually, if I could do anything in the world, what would it be? And I really took some time to reflect. You know, I was using law of attraction then, so I'd visualize. And what I did is I started to visualize leaving corporate I personally, I visualize leaving corporate with a lump sum. Yeah. Because I wanted to leave, I wanted them to pay me, right? So I was like, right, okay, I'm going to leave corporate and I'm going to set up a business. And I just started to visualize myself waking up in the morning, you know, not like walking down to my home office, you know, living in a beautiful house, the house that I wanted to live in. So really taking the opportunity to really dig into what I wanted to do. And then I started to be so grateful. Like, I was really so grateful for this opportunity. Like, every day I'd be in the shower, thank you so much for the opportunity. Thank you so much for the opportunity for my new business. Thank you so much for, you know, providing me the opportunity to leave my job. And just so, so grateful. And I manifested it pretty quickly. I think from the minute I made the decision until I left, it was about 2 months. Now, you know, you might be in a different situation. It might be a bit more forced and maybe a bit quicker than me. And yes, you can say, well, Abby, that's all right for you. That was your decision and you manifest a redundancy. I'm not in that position, but that's fine. And I get that, but it's all about mindset and it's all about shifting your perspective. You can either be in victim. Oh, this is terrible. This is happening to me. My life is over. Or you can use it as an opportunity to really empower yourself and really to go into what you want to do. And that could be, I want to go traveling for a year. It could be, I want to go step into that job. It could be, I want to start a business. Whatever it is, it's a gateway. And don't worry at the moment about how you're going to support yourself. Oh, I'm an entrepreneur. I have no idea where the money's coming in every month. Like, you know, that's literally, it's like a roller coaster journey, but I know without a doubt that money comes in to cover, you know, my business expenses and all my outgoings and to pay my bills and for me to be able to travel to beautiful places and pay for villas to take women to. You know, it all comes in. You just need to believe it. And it's your choice. It's like I said before, you're going to prove yourself right. Your ego is running the show. So you can either decide that you're going to make something incredible out of this opportunity or you're not. Yep. It's your decision. Whatever you do, that Henry Ford quote, whether you think you can do it or you can't do it. I'd probably misquoted him now. Yeah. But, you know, whether you think you can do it or you can't do it, you're right. You are. You're right. Yeah. It's your reality. You are in the driving seat. You have full control over what you're doing at the moment. It might not feel like it, but you have. So have faith.
Yes, 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 yes. I love it. I just want to drive that point home because, you know, I know because it's who I was that I got so caught up in it sounding really woo-woo. But the fact that you, you know, like really visualized and created this life in your mind before you brought it to life, everything is created twice. Whether it's the shirt that I'm wearing, our earrings, the computer that we're using, the car we drive, what our house is built from, everything is created twice. We've got to imagine it before we can build it. So why doesn't that apply to our lives? Which of course it does. So I love that. And I love that story. So I think I'm just getting conscious of time, we're getting closer to the end. But if you were to think of, if I could ask you the most bold, daring, audacious thing you've done in your life, you may have already covered it, but it's just a question that I love to ask. What comes in?
Oh my goodness. There's so many things that I've done. I mean, you know, I've done many bold, audacious things that have led me to, you know, I up sticks and went and worked as a nanny in America when I was 19. When I was 23, I went on holiday to Turkey and met a Turkish waiter and packed in my job and went to live with him. Yeah. And then had this amazing life for 10 years, not with him, but like traveling all over the world, you know, leaving my job, taking that leap of faith. I think every time I step out of my comfort zone, I think for me, stepping out of my comfort zone is definitely around money. Like, I carried a lot of money stories into my business from my corporate career and from my family. They're not my money beliefs, they're my parents' money beliefs, but I carried them with me, and that is something that is I'm constantly working on, and I'm getting better and better and better. I think for me, every time I make a big investment,
yeah,
So, you know, like this month, I've made huge investments. I've launched 2 retreats. I've paid outright for the villas. I've joined a high level coaching program. I've signed up to go to another retreat myself. Like that's a, you know, that's a big, is a big investment. Every time I really sort of like, whatever that comfort zone is, if I push myself out of it, what is at the other end is incredible. And the more scared I am, the more juicy it is at the other end. So if I think about that, yeah, that that ratio, I think, how terrified am I on a scale of 1 to 10? Okay, I'm 10. I'm really terrified. Well, I'm going to do it. Because it's going to be, whatever's at the other side of that fear is going to be incredible.
Yeah.
So yeah, but I think really for me, it's probably, it is leaving my corporate job. It really is, because that was such a big leap of faith. Yeah. And as much as I hated my job, it was my comfort zone. I was in my comfort zone and I took myself out of that comfort zone. And that was nearly 5 years ago. And I've just had the most incredible, incredible experiences, you know, to wake up every day and to feel pure joy, about what you do. And also to really, really witness other women going through transformation. They would not be creating the success within their lives if I hadn't have taken the leap of faith and become their teacher.
Yeah.
So I'm grateful every single day for every opportunity that I have.
Yeah, I'm grateful that you've done it, because if you haven't, we wouldn't be having this conversation. I think about, you know, Tony Robbins talks about the 6 human needs, and I won't go through them, but the first 2 are certainty and uncertainty. So feeling bored in our life just means we've got way too much certainty and not enough uncertainty. So it's time for an audacious decision. It's always a surefired way to get that zest for life back. I know you have a beautiful gift for our audience. Could you take a minute to tell us what it is?
Yeah, absolutely. So I'd love for you to go and grab hold of it. So it's a Big Change, Small Steps roadmap. I believe that it's not just about taking the big leaps, it's also the small, the little steps that will get you there. So it's like a 5-step, I don't really like to use my five-step process. It's not a 5-step process. It's just 5 things that I always cover with my clients, whether they're working with me privately or they're coming on one of my retreats. It's the 5 things that I cover with them when they first start to work with me. And it's just a lovely little worksheet that you can work through. You can go off and do some assignments yourself. And I think it's just a really good starter, especially if you're in this position where you're not quite sure what your next step is. I think it might give you some clarity. Well, it will definitely give you some clarity around that, I know. So that's really what it is. It's just me sharing some of those things, those insights that I share with my clients when I first work with them.
It's very generous, and it couldn't be more perfect considering the conversation we've just had. Beautiful. Thank you so much for sharing your story so beautifully and for your generosity in sharing your wisdom. It's been a beautiful interview, and I'm just so grateful that you shared with us.
Thanks, Edwina. And, you know, thank you for creating this. It's just so beautiful what you're doing, and the fact that you're bringing all these incredible, you know, humans together. And just creating this movement, it's just such an honor to be part of it. And thank you for doing the work that you're doing.
Yeah. I get to pinch myself every day and go, oh my goodness, is this work? It's not that hard.
Great, isn't it?
It's a joy. Yeah. Thank you so much, Abby.
Thank you.
Hello, gorgeous soul. I'm actually recording this outro, what I call it outro, the end to an interview. The next day, it was getting so late when I finished Abby's interview that I thought I'd come back when I had a bit more light again to get this done. But, you know, I've been thinking ever since the interview about when she saw the yellow car, yellow truck. And it's just, I remember, I want to share this story with you. You know, I used to, with four children, I needed a great big people mover. We used to live out in the country and I often had about 10 kids. You know, we would carpool and do different things between three different families. And so I had a great big people mover, my van. And I remember when we left the country and moved into town, I was, you know, quite excited to be able to sell that and get a normal car, but I still needed a six-seater car, but I just wanted something that was smaller and I didn't have to fight in the car parks at the supermarket to find a spot that fit. And so I started looking and I came across a Peugeot. Now, Peugeots had never been on my radar. I had no idea that they did a five-seater. And I went and tried one and found this fantastic secondhand Peugeot that I ended up buying, but I had never seen them. I thought nobody drove them. I thought there were none around, but all of a sudden they were on my radar. And so I started seeing them everywhere. So many people drive Peugeots. I saw them all over the road every time I went out. Whereas before, I thought I had never seen them before. So this is the power of our conscious and subconscious minds. When something comes into our conscious mind, it is front and center. When it's in our subconscious mind, it's actually all the things that are in our brain, in our memory bank, get highly filtered. It's like a filing cabinet, and it pulls out the things that are a priority, the things that we know we want to see, and other things get tucked away. This is something that happens while we're sleeping, which is one reason why sleep is so important. Part of the sleeping process is like organizing this filing cabinet. That's just by the by. So bringing something into the conscious mind and telling yourself that this is what I want to see, this is what I want to find, this is what I, you know, want help with, bringing it forward into the conscious mind, into your awareness, is where we start to see what we're looking for. So I would invite you, if you've never done this, to start playing a game with it. It can be fun. So think about something that perhaps has been on your radar, or, you know, something that you want to bring into your life. Get intentional with it. And really, you know, like, you can write yourself a goal, or, you know, as much as possible, bring it into the physical world. So I, you know, I'm a big fan of vision boards, as many of you will know, because I, you know, a picture's worth a thousand words. But, you know, if you find a picture or you just want to write words down, make it front and center and just see how this thing starts showing up in your life. Or if it's something that you want to achieve, once you bring it into the front and center of your mind, you will start to receive answers on the how. So this is one of the big things that I teach in vision building. It's like, forget the how, come up with the crazy, audacious, fantastic, exciting vision. And then the how slowly starts to present itself. I promise, I've done this so many times and it works and it's fun. But just start to play with it. That is my invitation to you today. All right, that's it from me today. So much love. And bye for now.